Hello, Lawrence community. It's really a pleasure to be with you today. I'm on campus, and we have number 17 in the house, specifically in Main Hall. We're in Strange Commons. I'm sure many of you know this space. It's named for John G. Strange, class of 1932. The Strange family was a fantastically important family to the Lawrence community, and John actually served on the Board of Trustees for almost 50 years. So it's a beautiful way to connect our history to our future. And the future is President Carter's future. And I'm sure many of you have followed the announcement of President Carter and having her join the Lawrence community. I am super excited about that, and I'm sure many of you are as well. I also want to mention that Laurie and I and everyone in the room is also very thoughtful and careful about observing the pledge. Obviously, Laurie and I are unmasked today. We've both been vaccinated and are past our time, and we're also sitting at a distance. But also all the crew in here are masked, and we really believe that we must observe the pledge in all situations. So I'm sure that's something you're thinking about at home, wherever home is. And again, thank you so much for joining us today. So great to have you here, Laurie.
Thank you, Mark. And thank you to the entire Lawrence community. I really am excited to be here and just honored to be number 17.
Yeah, it's awesome, isn't it? It's odd to have a number next to your name. I was never like, you know, Mark Burstein III or anything. Do you have that in your family at all? Or
not really. So here we go, right?
Yeah, exactly.
We're starting a new tradition in our family.
Exactly. So I will always have 16 attached
right.
to me, and you will always have 17.
I will.
Has it been something you've thought about, this sort of this arc or, you know, being 17th or...
So I have to tell you, and this may seem a little odd to everyone, but it's my second 17th.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
At Shippensburg, you're also 17.
I am.
Wow,
so
it's a lucky number.
That right? That's right. It is a lucky number for me and a number that I have really come to embrace. And so for me, being 17 means, you know, the opportunity to grow and thrive with the community of Lawrence University, and I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, and I think, you know, for me, sweet 16, so I thought hopefully that, you know, fingers crossed, that was going to be a little bit of my experience, but it's also this part of being part of a continuum, right? Thinking
yes.
about, like, I'm not one, I'm not 15, I'm not 20, I am 16 and trying to figure out what that means. I don't know, do you have even from a Shippensburg perspective, what is 17 meant?
Well, you know, and that's the interesting thing for me because Shippensburg was my first presidency and Lawrence is my second, but I learned so much in my first that I bring with me mm-hmm. to the second, so mm-hmm. it makes sense that it's a continuation of 17. Mm-hmm. I'm taking all of that information mm-hmm. that I gained through the first presidency and mm-hmm. building on that for the Lawrence community in a way that will really serve Lawrence and mm-hmm. its culture and, mm-hmm. and its students. And they will be able to benefit from that experience.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just interesting, this whole sort of continuum and what do you bring and how do you think about your placement? And it's a complicated, at least for me, I found it to be very complicated, interesting and important, but very, very complicated.
It certainly can be. But I really view leadership sort of as a continuum,
mm-hmm,
right? We're always learning and growing, and this is a part of that process.
Yeah, yeah, and I think that is something similar for both of us. I was talking to number 15 this week, and very sadly, and I think the Lawrence community knows this, that in my first year of presidency, we lost number 14, Rick Warsh, and we also lost two other of our presidents in that year.
Oh.
So there's really now only the three of us. And I think that's a, at least for me, a huge loss. I got a chance to meet Rick and spend time with him before he passed. But, you know, having people around like that, it really sort of enriches. I know at Shippensburg, do you have other numbered folks around?
Well, I do, actually. And one of those numbered folks served at the university for over 20 years and has been a tremendous mentor for me, Tony Sedia. Just such an incredible legacy at the university, and so many of the traditions that exist there now were created during his tenure, and I've been so grateful for that. So I certainly understand what you're talking about. That loss could be tremendous. I can't imagine having had the successful presidency I had without Tony.
Yeah, and my last campus, we had four former presidents on campus, as well as one of the former presidents of Harvard and Duke. And just having that resource as a senior leader of an institution to be able to not only work with your existing team, but to be able to go to other folks and say, I'm sure you've seen this movie before, and could you give me a little bit of a sense of how you approach that and what that, it adds to the resources that you have.
It's invaluable, and it's absolutely essential. And I am grateful because I bring with me sort of a team of resources of former and current presidential mentors who really do help bring clarity and help better define where we are now in the higher ed landscape and how that informs the work.
Yeah. So, and this was one of my questions was, you know, what, and when you think about Shippensburg, Lawrence, how do you think about similarities, differences? What do you bring? What do you learn? Like, and also this, you know, one of the, I think, really powerful parts of your career is this back and forth between public and private. And they really have strengths. They each bring strengths, I would say, from the educational perspective. So how do you think about all those pieces put together?
And for me, coming to Lawrence at this time in the history of higher education and in the landscape of higher education, when the publics and privates are coming closer together than they've ever been in terms of the similar challenges dealing with the pandemic and the impact that that has had on enrollment and finances and really viewing it through that lens. From my perspective, I have pieces in my toolkit that come from both. Mm-hmm. And coming to Lawrence, I'm really drawing upon my experience in the private education world where I spent most of my time, but also in the last 7 years when I've been at Publix and higher ed has been transformed so dramatically, mm-hmm. just disrupted, mm-hmm. really. So issues like enrollment and how one is managing enrollment, and enrollment, of course, includes retention and recruitment. It has shifted the mindset about that. The use of data, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. Curricular innovation and the use of technology, both in curriculum and in how students are prepared to go out into the world, and you know, the disruption of technology in the workforce is impacting how we have to prepare our students. So all of those pieces exist in both landscapes.
Mm-hmm. For
but,
sure.
But you know, the private world does have its unique challenges. And I think that my experience in both has prepared me to be able to address those equally as well. You know, budgets and fundraising and the impact that the pandemic has had on those issues. Mm-hmm. Lawrence as a liberal arts institution, I think, is so uniquely positioned to be a leader for what society needs from us. So it's really exciting to bring all of that together.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I think one of the things that was, I think, exciting for me about your background is that also I believe public institutions have a better understanding of how to work with their host municipalities. And, you know, one of the beautiful traditions of Lawrence, right, is this idea, Amos Lawrence and his wife, Sarah Appleton Lawrence, right? Or this, in essence, marriage we have between Appleton and Lawrence University. And so it's important in the DNA of Lawrence, but it isn't necessarily important in the DNA of every private institution.
Absolutely. And it is not always in the DNA of the public.
Okay. Okay.
Although
my fantasy. They've sorted it all out. Those publics and I, we're still struggling through.
They haven't really. I have been a very active member in ASCU, which is the Association of State Colleges and Universities, and in ASCU we talk about being stewards of place because that's really what public institutions. Mm-hmm. were created to be.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think that we're doing a better job of that, but there's work to be done. When I arrived in Shippensburg, for instance, one of our priorities became our relationship with the community because I heard so much from folks on and off campus about how that relationship needed to be strengthened. Mm-hmm. And so, next Friday, actually, we will be opening Shippensburg University's very first downtown location in Shippensburg.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so that is 4 years of work.
And you don't have to do that here. We're already downtown, right?
That's right.
Yeah, that's set. That, you don't have to really
that's
put
right.
energy behind that.
Which is great.
But it is so important to have a presence, right? Having a physical presence really does make a difference.
It does make a difference. And it says to the community, we want to be a part of you.
Yeah.
And I was so pleased to be able to meet with the mayor of Appleton. Jake is of course, a Lawrence.
Our very own class of 2013.
that's right.
Jacob Woodford.
And, and a fourth generation Appletonian. Mm-hmm. So what better time to strengthen a relationship? And, and I know that you have done really good work in that regard. But Jake wants to deepen that, and I am enthusiastic about doing that with him.
And one of the things that's always been funny is when my colleagues from the East Coast say, well, what is Lawrence really like? I always start off by saying, we're an urban campus. And that completely blows their mind. Like, how could that be? You're in northeastern Wisconsin and you're an urban campus. But we truly are, right? We are in the middle of a city.
Yes.
I think that's a beautiful, really, really beautiful thing.
It is, and it's wonderful for the students to know that they're not isolated. They are part of a larger community and can participate in that community.
And I think it's also a challenge, right? Which is making sure that the community supports and embraces all of our students all
Correct.
The time has also been a challenge for us. And I think something that Jake's been very focused on.
It's really part of our role as educators to help them really be prepared, not just for the workplace, but for life.
Yeah.
And so being an urban campus allows us to do that in a way that's actually more organic than when you're not an urban campus.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point. So, of course, a classic question, early impressions, Lawrence, Appleton, Wisconsin.
Such warm and wonderful people. And that is really one of the things that attracted me so much. The university is doing great work. It has such a special mission. But the people here are committed to the campus, to the students, to the community, in a way that you don't see everywhere. And I've worked on a lot of different campuses. So my first impression is that this community is prepared to do what it needs to do to ensure that Lawrence continues to be a top-notch university, graduating students who are going out to change the world.
Yeah, and Laurie, I'm with you 100%, right? Not only this, and I felt this even in the search committee, in the presidential search committee, right? This warmth and connection, but also focus on mission, right?
Yes.
A collective focus on mission. It's not a place, you know, I'm sure I've been in other places where people pull in different directions.
Yes.
They may be personally connected, but in a large university, there's a tendency to sometimes go in different directions and say, no, this is not our mission. This is our mission.
Precisely.
But this sort of clear sense of what Lawrence's future can be and should be is just palpable here.
It is. It is. And my interviews were on Zoom, but I felt it over Zoom. Mm-hmm. It is powerful. And it makes a difference. It makes a difference in how we are able to work together as a community to address the challenges before us. It makes a difference in how the students feel a sense of belonging on campus. It makes a difference in how the faculty and staff feel supported and engaged in the life of the campus.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So, and for those of you who are not in Wisconsin, in Appleton right now, we had maybe an hour-long hailstorm right before Laurie landed. And those of us in Sampson House were saying, oh, we hope this is over before Laurie has to get out of the plane, because we don't really want her to be introduced again to the Wisconsin weather. But
and it was over.
Yeah. So, but sense of Wisconsin, any initial views or Appleton or?
I've met with the big guy of Appleton, and he's setting the tone for the community. As I have gone around the community, once again, a sense of community, which is wonderful, mm-hmm. because when you're in a larger city, you don't always feel mm-hmm. that. But also a sense of place in the world, a sense of place in the state. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I want to engage in that. I feel really excited about the opportunity to be a part of a larger community that is having an impact in the region and in the state in the way that Appleton and the Fox Cities are. There are so many things that I want to experience here that I'm really looking forward to.
Yeah, and I think, Laurie, what you mentioned also about scale, you know, we both worked at institutions in Manhattan,
yes.
in New York City.
Yes.
And I think one of the things, at least for me, that was challenging there was that when a student thought about service out in the community, obviously there were many, many opportunities, but the ability of the student to feel like they were truly making an impact, given the enormity of, you know, of the issues facing New York City, it was really hard to do that. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about being located in Appleton, the Fox Cities. Our students are doing meaningful service, and they see that, they experience that.
And it matters. It makes a difference. And you know, when you are providing service, you're not necessarily doing it to make yourself feel better, but that's a byproduct of it, right? But I think the students can feel even better when they're seeing the fruits of their labor improving their community or really contributing to their community. And as you said, in a much larger city, there are so many things going on that can sometimes get lost.
Yeah, exactly. So what about, you know, when you think about another classic question, what drew you to LU? Why did you decide to join us at this, you know, extraordinary place?
Well, and I know this sounds a little cliche, but I really was drawn to the light. And the light of Lawrence for me has to do with its mission, its commitment to students, the collaboration between the liberal arts and the arts, which is one of my personal passions, and this strong sense of community and understanding of the landscape of higher education. But the real clincher for me were the students. I had the opportunity to talk with students and their passion for Lawrence, their passion for learning, their understanding of the gift that they have in this university is very special. Mm-hmm. And I think that anyone who has the opportunity to experience that would be drawn in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a beautiful thing. I just on welcome gifts, I have gifts that were given to me in the office that I need to hand off to you. And two of them are a Swedish and Norwegian joke books. just to prepare you for the Wisconsin culture, but also Wisconsin idioms, like a ramp. What would you think a ramp is?
Well, something you drive up, perhaps?
Totally. That's exactly what I thought it was. It is what we call parking garages here.
Oh.
Well, the first time someone said, you need to put your car on the ramp, I was like, wouldn't that block the other cars? Like, aren't I supposed to put it in a space, not on the ramp itself?
Oh, I definitely need that book.
Yes, exactly.
I'll be in trouble.
Exactly. We speak English here, but we have different idioms as well.
Right, which is what we find everywhere,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. On this theme, East Coast to Midwest. Mm-hmm. How are you thinking about that? Sort of geography, culture, feeling?
So, you know, it's interesting because I spent most of my life on the East Coast. And hadn't really thought much about where else I could possibly live, but was always open to the possibility of living somewhere else. And so when we moved to Kentucky, everyone thought, oh my, Kentucky, you're going to the South from the Northeast. And I loved living in Kentucky. Experiencing it was a different culture. It was a different approach to life. It was a slower pace. And so that lesson taught me that there's value in every experience of living, right? But you have to go into it with an open mind. You can't go into it expecting it to be what you always knew. During the pandemic, I say to my team all the time, we cannot look to what we knew. We have to look to what is new. And so that's how I'm approaching this experience. I have friends from the Midwest who love living in the Midwest, love its culture and its experiences, and I'm sure I will as well. And so I look to embrace it and to engage in it and to learn about it and become a Midwesterner.
So what drew you to Kentucky? Was it the opportunity or?
It was. I left higher ed because my mother was ill. And I stepped out of higher ed because I had to care for her. So the opportunity to go to Kentucky was really stepping back into higher education, which is my passion, right? I just had to do it in a very different place. And sometimes life leads us to, you know,
for sure,
to where we're supposed to be, but not on the path we thought it was on.
Yeah.
And so I embraced the opportunity and had a really great experience there.
And this is something I try to express to students and recent alum all the time, which is serendipity in a career. You can't underestimate that, right? Things just happen sometimes. You know, I think that this generation, at least my experience, many of them think I'm going to have a plan and I'm going to do this and then I'm going to do this. And I'm like, well, you know, that's all sounds good. And I also had a plan like that, but, you know, I didn't follow that in any way.
That's right. And you know, I went to Kentucky to work with a gentleman I met while doing a collaboration with a university in Utah. So it's also one of those things where you never know where a relationship may lead you.
Agreed.
And so who knew that this gentleman that I met decades before would become, you know, the president of a university and draw me to an entirely different region in the country.
So we have questions from our community, I think, that...
Before we get to those,
yes.
May I ask you a couple of questions?
Oh, okay.
All right, we're going to turn
the
table.
But you're the woman of the hour.
A couple of things that will really be helpful to
me.
What is your favorite Lawrence tradition?
When the community gathers has really been milestones for me in my time here at Lawrence. So obviously commencement, you know, the epitome of gatherings, but also athletic events, performances, you know, just remembering those and experiencing those and the tradition of us gathering for those convocations, really just have really been milestones for me in a beautiful way.
That's wonderful. Well, I hope that we can gather again in the more traditional sense as we're working our way through this pandemic.
Yes, and we are gathering for commencement this year.
Wonderful.
In the Bonta Bowl, in the renovated Bonta Bowl. We're super excited about it. It will look like no other commencement we've ever had, 6 feet distant and no handshaking, as you said, and
right.
a bunch of other things. But I think just trying to find ways back to that, given the constraints,
right.
but back to that, I think is so important for us as an institution.
That's great. I could not agree more. And then one other question.
Yeah, please.
An important, I think, initiative that you've started is becoming an anti-racist institution.
Mm.
Why did you decide to do that?
You know, I think for many of us, our journey to being equity-minded is both a personal one and also an institutional one. You know, I have the privilege of either sharing my difference or not. And so that changes the dynamic very significantly, but I have experienced what it means to be in an environment where you can't be fully yourself, where, and how limiting that is, and how painful that is, how it really prevents someone from truly becoming their best self. So from there, you know, you think about that and say, well, it's critical for a learning organization to create an environment where every one of our students, as well as every one of our faculty and staff members, can truly bring their whole selves to the experience and not feel that they're institutionally we're against that, or culturally we're against that. So for me, that's being anti-racist. So I can't imagine an educational institution that isn't striving to be anti-racist. And I do want to focus on the word striving, right? It is a everyday, evergreen piece of work that I feel like I'm still learning about and trying to figure out my own place in it and my own efforts and how to make sure that they are successful. But I think we are, you know, as a campus community and as an institution as well. How do you think about this, Laurie? How do you put this in your own sort of personal arc and institutional arc?
Well, I could not agree with you more. Being a BIPOC individual, I have been in those situations where there is a sense that you can't truly be yourself. And we are only our best selves when we can be who we should be in the world. And so I applaud your courage in taking that step, making that statement. Because there's a difference between sort of taking the steps and not making a statement, or making a statement and not taking the steps, and you've decided to do them both.
Yeah, and I appreciate that, but I don't feel like I deserve applause. I feel like it is incumbent on me to do this work, and it's not something that I should get positive reinforcement for. It's really something that is a responsibility for me in the world, and certainly as a college president. I mean, I can't, you know, like, I don't know how you can be a college president and not care deeply about this work and try to steward your institution forward in the best way you possibly can.
Well, I agree with that, and I I'm looking forward to the opportunity to carry this vision through, but I thank you for it.
And Laurie, I'm super excited about seeing it from the sidelines. I will watch all the announcements and be applauding. And
you'll come back and join in.
Anytime you want me, I'm here. I'm definitely here. So I think our community has a wide range of questions, which is classic Laurentian. The questions range from the idiosyncratic to the broad and institutional. So for those of you who have not been following this, Andrew Commons has been open all year. The Bringle Dining Room is open after we get to a certain place in terms of our testing and hopefully the lack of virus on campus. So I've had the pleasure of eating in the Bringle Dining Room every term, and I try to actually eat there when it's open two or three times a week. So I have experienced Meatless Mondays. I'm a big fan. For those who don't know, I'm a little bit challenged on the food front. I'm gluten, dairy, and egg-free. So Meatless Mondays could be a little bit of an odyssey looking for the right things, but there's always something for me to eat. From a sustainability perspective, being vegetarian does really help the planet in some significant ways, or even just decreasing our consumption of meat. And also, I think it is great from a health perspective. So it really focuses all of us on, you know, food does really matter in our health, and Meatless Monday maybe is a reminder for all of us. But where are you, Laurie, on vegetarian eating on campus? What's your passions here?
Well, I agree with you that there certainly are health benefits to it. And I fully support Meatless Monday. My husband is a pescatarian.
Oh.
My son is a chickatarian, and he is a conservationist. Mm. So I understand the benefits of really cutting down on having so much meat consumption. And I applaud it. And in my home, you can probably imagine, we eat a lot of meals without meat.
Yes, or also a lot of meals that are different from each other. I've never even heard of a chickatarian before.
He only eats, chicken is his only form of meat.
Does he eat fish also?
No.
Interesting.
He stopped eating fish when he was about 10.
Mm.
And at that point, he was really only eating fish sticks. But he is a marine scientist,
okay.
And he is passionate about our marine friends.
Okay. Well, and I think also, I don't know about you, both of us are dog owners.
Yes.
I think having another animal in your life, at least for me, has dramatically changed, you know, first my connection to the animal world, but also thinking about how important animals are to us.
They are, and how sad it is actually that some are simply raised to be eaten. But I won't get into that.
yeah, totally.
I do eat meat. I am the odd person out in my family, but not often because my family doesn't.
Yeah.
And I'm perfectly fine with a meatless meal.
Okay, there you go. Well, I guess Andrew Commons is all set up for you now, which is great.
Thank you. I think that is exactly what I will do, keep up the tradition of open communication and make it my own. One of the things that I think is very important is for me to understand the culture, to listen to the community and to hear what's important to them. And I know Mark has done some really terrific things here. And I want to make sure that I honor that tradition and that culture. But I have to make it my own, as we discussed before. Otherwise, it's not authentic. And one of the leadership lessons that I've learned is never try to be someone else. I have to really work with this community in a way that's authentically Laurie, but let them know that I care about them. And that I honor the things that they think are important. And as someone who really sort of grew up in the student affairs area, communication with students, collaboration, engagement around campus is it's really just something I do. It's part of my DNA.
And I think it's also something for you and also for me that you get energy from, right?
Yes.
Right. It draw, at least for me. The connection really makes the job more fun,
so
it's hard to avoid, right? Like
it's
something you really want to do.
Is. Well, it's why we're in this profession.
Totally.
We're in the profession to connect with people, not to sit in our offices and work on policies all day.
Exactly. God, I hope not. You know, like, that doesn't sound like a lot of fun. Yeah, I think one of the exciting things for me about this transition is that Laurie and I have already talked about these issues. And, you know, I feel like we've established a very comfortable conversation. And I feel like she's headed exactly in the right direction, which is learn the place, you know, listen and learn, and think about the sort of the strategic challenges, right? You know, I think one of the challenges with starting in a new place is people want to pull you into the detail. Oh, I want you to think about this, or I want you to think about that. And those things are so important. But they could really crowd out the larger issues that are really a president's job. And, you know, you've really know that balance already. And I can see it playing out in your existing, you know, when I've been with you, you've really got that balance done. I don't know, how have you been thinking about this?
Well, that's how I think about it. And as you said, I've done it before. And the first time around worked, and I think worked well. I really spent a lot of time listening to people, not making big decisions without understanding the culture, not sort of picking off pieces of it without having the big picture in mind. And it takes a lot of listening and discussion and processing to get to the place where it's time to begin to make some decisions. I've had the benefit of having, you know, all of this time that I'm having with you. And that helps because it allows me to know, you know, every president leaves something on the table, right? They do.
I hope that they're all nicely wrapped and enjoyable presents as opposed to
they usually are. And I won't resent you for it.
Thank you.
So you have to balance all of those things.
But Laurie's right. You know, not everything can be tied up with a bow, and that's the organic nature of the institutions that we lead, right? That is, you know, inherent in what we do.
It is. And that's why the communication between the two of us is vital to the transition.
Yeah.
So
and also so reassuring to me, right? You know, an institution that you know, I've invested my life's blood into in a way that has given back to me, multiply. But it's, you know, I want to make sure that, you know, the next person will be completely different than me, because I think an institution really benefits from that, but will also do the same. And I've felt that from you from the very beginning, and I really, really appreciate that.
Well, I like everyone here I've met on campus, think you have done a tremendous job, and I want to honor it.
Yes, and I will still have things left on my desk. I am really continue to be moved how much the goal of supporting every student and family financially in the way that we feel we should for our own methodology has resonated with the community. And now raising over $90 million to support students and families. It's quite honestly, it's moving to me every single day, meeting students and seeing how this effort has really touched them personally and also the trajectory of their lives. I'm so proud of the faculty who have really worked very hard on curricular innovation. You know, curriculum has been something that needs to be renewed every year. We try to renew it hopefully every year since 1847. And I'm sure you will pick this up as well, thinking about this. But, you know, they've just really been such leaders. And back to your point earlier of we're a community that understands where we need to go. Mm-hmm. And I think for me, the third is the conversation we had earlier that we are, I think, hopefully productively focused on being an anti-racist institution, an equity-minded institution, and what that means. We still have a long way to go, but I'm hoping that we have momentum in this area as well.
Getting to know the Lawrence family more. I am really excited about learning from, learning with, learning alongside every member of this community. I think it's being left in very good shape, and this community has done tremendous work to move through the shifting higher ed landscape, and that is due to the superb leadership that Mark has given it. And I just look forward to really rolling up my sleeves and working with the community to continue to achieve the goals that it has set for itself, to ensure that its mission is well lived and that its students are served well.
And I think one of the things that your answer reminded me of was your announcement and the posts that were on social media and just really on the YouTube screen, right, as we revealed that you were a woman. And, you know, there's just such enthusiasm. So super excited to have number 17 in the House, President Carter. It's just great. And thank you so much for joining us. I hope that for those of you who haven't been on campus, that you'll come back when it's possible for the pandemic and think about Lawrence. And I'm sure Laurie will enjoy hearing from all of you in this first year of hers. So again, thank you so much for joining us today.